Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, Fuel Rod Reversal, the holidays have moved in with the help of some VIPs, more merchandise has arrived.
A celebrity visits Galaxy's Edge, DCA recovers from Halloween, we talk about a Disney legend, and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
Hello and welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of November 6, 2019. I'm Teresa Urban.
And I'm Tig Bushman. We'd like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our patrons for supporting the show. This support helps make DL Weekly possible. Our patrons get some pretty nice perks like access to our Discord chat, live shows, some DL Weekly swag, and more. If you'd like to learn more, head on over to dlweekly.net/support.
Just a reminder to all of our supporters that are at the annual pass holder level and above, next week will be our live stream of us recording the show. So be sure to tune in for that. Well, it is that time of year again when we want to hear from you. If you have a few minutes, please head on over to dlweekly.net/survey and fill out our listener survey. This will help us to understand what the community likes, doesn't like, and how we can make DL Weekly even better for everyone.
Yeah, we've gotten some great feedback already from that. So thank you guys. For those of you who have filled it out, thank you so much. Does listening to the show make you want to be in the park? I know it makes me want to be in the park. If so, contact James, Mike, and Scott over at ConciEARS to get your next trip planned. They made our trips truly memorable and hassle-free. If you want the same experience, head on over to ConciEARS.com and chat with them about what your dream Disney vacation looks like. Maybe you're a Disneyland expert but want to check out Disney World, Disneyland Paris, Alani, or even a Disney cruise? Even better, they can help with all of those. Remember, there is no additional cost to book through them, and you get a year of touring plans free when you mention that DL Weekly sent you.
Now let's get to the news. After all of the outrage online about the $3 swap fee coming to the fuel rods at Disneyland, the company and Disney have both announced that there will not be a fee to swap the chargers for a fresh one. The area of the kiosk that stated the fee have been covered up, and we expect new signage will be swapped in to look more permanent and a little less temporary.
So this was interesting because there was a couple kind of groups of people online this week when this was announced. There was a group of people who were like, who cares? Like, I didn't expect it to be like a thing forever. So like $3, not a big deal. Then there were the people that were like, how dare you? You said unlimited swaps, which they didn't say free swaps. They just said unlimited swaps. And people were like, but they never said it was going to cost something. And people freaked out. Disney and Fuel Rod, I think, did the right thing here. And I think they just backed off of it because I think it's so much better. I think if they went to this $3 thing at Disneyland, I don't think it would be as popular. So
no, definitely not.
What do you think? I know you have a horse in this race.
I you know, I'm very happy that they did this because being a new to Fuel Rod person, because I did just purchase mine during my last trip, I didn't feel that I had gotten my $30 value out of it yet. I think I had only swapped it twice, maybe. So
sure.
that didn't quite make the difference for us. I know there's a lot of talk in our chat and just online in general. Why, you know, ask people that didn't have fuel rods, basically asking why fuel rod owners were so upset about this. And yeah, the big thing that we kind of said was the chargers themselves weren't that great. You could definitely buy better ones online. But the whole like reason that they were valuable was the fact that you could just swap them out at the park. So it came in really convenient, you know, very convenient, very handy for me to use it and then just be able to instantly have a new fresh charge on versus if I brought in my own battery pack, you'd have to sit there and charge it again, which I don't know of any charging stations or charging areas that you can do that at either of the parks or even in the resort, you know, even in downtown Disney. So that's not really a good option. So I'm glad they did it. I think they could have gotten away with adding the fee if they would have started at like $1 a swap. But $3 was just very steep.
Do Do you think they're going to wait a period of time now, like 6 months or something, and wait for everybody to kind of forget about this and then maybe institute like a dollar fee? Or do you think that they're just like, we just lost?
I think how they've changed the signage, I think the fees will still be coming. Hopefully they'll be smarter about it and start small and then go up from there. Because honestly, if they would have implemented the $3 fee, I do not see fuel rods would have been lasting that long in the park. Sure. So I think a lot of people would have stopped using the kiosks.
I feel like the way they could get away with doing like a higher swap fee is I think they need, because one of the complaints about the fuel rods was the fact that they're actually not that great of a
battery. They really aren't. So from my experience with my iPhone 7, because I am not one of those people that has to have the newest and best phone, as long as it works, I'm good. But anyway, so even with having a kind of older phone, it would only charge my phone up to like, I want to say the one time that my phone was down, almost dead, it was just on fumes. I think the fuel rod, it took quite a while and it only got it up to like 60% maybe. So it didn't give me a full charge, which again, didn't really care because I could just swap it out and get a fresh charger right then. The other thing that is nice and was kind of a selling point to me was you get the charger, but then you also get multiple
adapters.
So you could share, you know, you could share your one fuel rod with friends. So like I have an iPhone, Vern has an Android. We could use the one fuel rod to charge both of our phones. And it does come in a nice little case. But really, if they would have, like I said last week, if they would have implemented the $3 fee, I don't think I would have brought it back with me.
So out of curiosity, why instead of doing the fuel rod, how come you didn't just get like a battery pack somewhere else?
To be real honest, the reason that I ended up purchasing a fuel rod was because I didn't have anything else. And so I just was at the park and I decided, you know what? We'll do it. I'm going to be at the parks more often because of the podcast. Yay. Sure. But so this makes sense. It's smaller. It's more compact. It has a really nice carrying case that actually is pretty. I'm not going to say it's actually waterproof, but I would say it's at least water resistant. It did go on Splash Mountain with me and it survived.
Good.
So it's just, it's nice. It's compact. Plus you get the free swaps. So it's just, I don't know, one less thing to have to worry about versus having an actual battery pack that then you have to remember to charge every night. And I don't know, just, I thought it was a little bit easier for me.
Sure. Well, Star Wars fans of the prequels might recognize a star that visited Star Wars Galaxy's Edge this past week. Hayden Christensen, better known by Star Wars fans as Anakin Skywalker, stopped into the new land with his daughter to experience Smuggler's Run and to build a lightsaber in Savi's workshop. It was his daughter's 5th birthday, and they spent the rest of the day at the resort. Of course, they had great photo ops of Hayden in the cockpit of the Millennium Falcon and in Savi's with his daughter, which I might add, she had a purple lightsaber.
I thought that was cute. I also thought it was very adorable in this article that Disney Parks posted. They were talking about how with it being her birthday, she got to decide what they did for the day. So she got to choose everything. So I guess I'm not sure if Galaxy's Edge was top priority, but I do know that they also headed off over into Disneyland and California Adventure to do what she wanted. I thought that was very cute.
Well, if your dad was Anakin Skywalker, you probably are a Star Wars fan at some level, wouldn't you think?
I would think so, but I don't know. Maybe she hasn't seen the movies yet. She's 5. I don't know.
That's true.
How would you have felt if you would have been walking around Galaxy's Edge and ran into Hayden Christensen?
Do you know what I think? So this is true. I think about this a lot because we talk about celebrities in the parks. Mm-hmm. And you know what's funny? I feel like I would always be in denial. Like, I feel like if I saw someone, I'd be like, is that really? Well, because when we were there, I saw the kid from the Goldbergs.
Oh, yeah.
And I was like, at first I wasn't sure, but then I saw like the plaids and stuff around him. I'm like, oh yeah, that's probably him. But like that one time when Beth and I were there and we saw Elijah Wood, like I didn't think it was him at first. So you know what I mean? Like I think I would talk myself out of it because like, what's the likelihood I'd see somebody? So I probably would just think that it wasn't him.
Well, Hatbox Ghost Tiki mugs are still available as of the recording of this podcast. So if any of you are looking to pick one up, you can still do so. Also, buttons promoting the Little Mermaid live musical on ABC were available outside of the Little Mermaid attraction in DCA this week ahead of the showing. The show aired Tuesday night, so we don't know if they still have them after the show.
Is this something that you're going to watch, The Little Mermaid?
I'm a little sad that I'm actually not watching it right now because it is airing as we speak and as we're recording this. I watched Actually, I think it was some ad that I saw on Instagram of all places. It looks actually really cool. I know I was kind of skeptical at first, but then kind of watching the preview, it looked very, very neat.
Is this the first like live musical that ABC's done? Because I know like NBC's done a couple. Like it's kind of been like a November tradition for NBC to do
Yeah, I guess I don't know.
If it does well, I wonder if we'll see other musicals, like if they do like an Aladdin
or Lion King.
Yeah, so that'd be kind of cool.
That'd be very cool.
And I like
cool.
the idea that it's live because like there's a whole like excitement to it because like they have to be extra crazy. Like, because I know we watched the Hairspray one that was on, I think, last year. And I remember just thinking how amazing it was that like they did it like on the back lot. And so they had this huge outdoor segment
wow,
and stuff.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, I know that's totally off topic of this. Are you surprised about the Hat Box Ghost Tiki Mug still being available?
I kind of am, but I guess I don't know if maybe everybody was so crazed and excited about them last year, and so now it's not as exciting this year since it's...
Do you think they ordered too many?
That could be too. Maybe they overstocked.
Yeah.
But we also have the awesome options of those very cool pins and the ornaments, too, so you don't have to have the mug specifically to still get in on the action, so that might be part of it as well.
Yeah. Well, one of our listeners was kind enough to send us... So last year, a listener sent us the actual
mugs, which are amazing.
This year, we didn't get an actual mug, which is totally fine. We got one of the ornaments, one of the pins,
which I think
is great.
I think was even better because, I don't know, the ornament is 100% going on my tree. And that pin is just... We've recently gotten into pins, and my goodness,
Well, you recently got into the pins.
You did too.
No, I've been into the pins.
Not quite the level you are now.
Maybe. I wasn't trading, but I was collecting.
You didn't really trade at the parks. We failed at trading at the parks.
But if you're a supporter and you watch the live shows, I actually have the ornament in the back of our new set.
We'll have to point it out during our next stream.
Well, it is no surprise that with the holidays starting this week, that the park has debuted some new merchandise. Included this year are some new spirit jerseys, of course, toys, sippers, bags, ears, and more. The color scheme for a lot of the items is black, white, and red. My favorite thing so far in all of this is the sipper. I really like the, there's like a snowman sipper. That's really hard to say, by the way.
It almost kind of looks like it's a snow cone or something, because the bottom looks like a traditional cup, and then the top is rounded.
Yeah.
So like the snowman hat. I do love that he has the classic Mickey ears hat on. I think my favorite, even though I would probably never actually purchase one for myself, is I do really like the design on the spirit jerseys. And that's just solely because I like the print, how it's kind of candy cane-esque.
I will say that I was just looking at this article and I was thinking that the 6th was Friday for some reason, but it's the 8th is Friday. Mm-hmm. So actually when this episode posts, you can actually get some of these, at least some of the wishables that are available on shopdisney.com.
For those of you that do enjoy shopping online at shopdisney.com, I did see a lot of this stuff available actually last week online.
Oh.
I was checking out, they had a really good sale, so I was checking that out.
I got a thing in the mail that was like giving me like 25% off with my Disney Visa card, and I got kind of excited because I was wondering if they had the Lego sets on there. Because 25% off of like a $400 or $300 Lego set, that's quite a bit of money. They do, but, I had some technical difficulties recently with my phone, so I don't have a budget for that, unfortunately.
Another new sipper is coming to the resort this holiday season. The new offering looks like a giant Mickey-shaped Christmas ornament. It is decorated with Mickey-shaped cutouts and is covered in a shiny red coating. The sipper should be available around the resort once the holiday season kicks off on November 8th.
I really like this one. I'm not usually a huge sipper fan, but like this looks amazing.
It's beautiful. So it doesn't, to me, it reminds me more of like bells.
Oh yeah,
more so than an ornament. It looks like the bottom is a, like the Mickey head portion looks like a bell, and definitely the ears look like two bells on it too. It's beautiful though.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm looking at it and it just really makes me want it. You know me, I'm not usually, I mean, I guess I kind of went popcorn bucket crazy recently, but I really like this. If I was there, I would totally be getting one of these.
That would be, to me, that's something that you could very easily add to like your just normal holiday decor around the house. I would definitely have this displayed in my house. It's very well done.
You know, you should just have your paycheck deposited directly to
Disney. I should.
Me too. Well, with the holiday season starting in just a couple of days, the decorations around the parks have really become apparent. Garland is up on Main Street. The iconic tree has been installed. Poinsettias have been planted. Land-specific themed decorations are also visible in Critter Country, Frontierland, and It's a Small World has almost completed its transformation.
Yeah, from what we were seeing online, it looked like pretty much all of the holiday decorations are up in Disneyland. It does look like there are some areas still over in DCA that have not fully transitioned behind in the holidays. They did have a lot of Halloween stuff up, so I'm sure it was maybe a little bit longer transition period for them.
Yeah.
Because think of Cars Land on Cars Land. I mean, that's a ton of Halloween stuff that they would have had to take all down.
Well, they took all that down. Mm-hmm. They just don't have any of the Christmas stuff up yet. Because
right.
In the article I saw, they were talking about how, like, you get a couple days in
yes.
between that
mm-hmm.
had totally mm-hmm. normal. And then, of course, the Christmas tree in DCA hasn't gone up, and the Buena Vista Street decorations haven't gone up. But Disneyland's like ready, man. Like they're like, we're ready to go. So,
well, and I think that makes sense because when people, you know, think of going to the Disneyland Resort, they think Disneyland, I would say, over California Adventure. So it makes sense to have Disneyland decked out,
so
ready to go at first.
I had a totally random thought today, and it probably isn't practical for a place like Disneyland, but I thought about this. A lot of the places they decorate are like shops, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, and the exteriors are shops. I thought that, like, wouldn't it be kind of cool if it was done like an actual, like, town where, like, each shop was responsible for, like, their decorations? So then you get a lot of variety. So, like, right now, like, and I know it's not just shops, but, like, Fantasyland doesn't have a lot of Christmas decoration. But wouldn't it be kind of cool if, like, some of the shops or something in Fantasyland, like, kind of took over and kind of made things, like, and then everything would kind of have a different, like, flair? They kind of do this anyway, but I just feel like it'd be easier for them to get everything up instead of one team trying to transform the whole park, if they had, like, a few people, like, spearhead the project at the little store, so then, like, everybody just had a little bit to do instead of one team having, like, the whole park to do. Does that make sense? You look like you're, like, confused what I'm saying.
No, it makes sense. But I'm just thinking, you know, you've worked in retail. I've worked in retail. I couldn't imagine working retail at Disneyland and then also having time to have to decorate my store. That was just what I was trying to figure out, was how would I be working at the store and also
transitioning? Well, there was crews where we worked before. There was crews that would, like, decorate for
the
holidays.
See, I guess I really like how it is now, how it's just like, this is how Frontierland does Christmas, and
yeah.
It's a very different feel, and you kind of have the unique garland and unique decorations up throughout Frontierland,
sure.
And then you transition to New Orleans Square, which is its very own different way of decorating and celebrating the holiday.
Yeah.
I like how you have kind of like different zones, I guess would say, be
well,
a good way
I'm
of explaining
fine with the
it.
Zones,
if
I was
you,
just
but
saying,
if you go into the shops,
yeah.
Each shop does have unique decor
right.
inside. It's just the outside is uniform, I guess.
I guess what I'm trying to say is people complain that like Christmas is creeping into Halloween. So I was just saying, instead of having a team, like you're obviously not going to hire hundreds of people to be on this decoration team, because you're only going to need them for a couple nights or whatever. I was just saying that, like, if you could wrangle up some regular cast members that can do some of the decorating, that frees that team up to do some of the bigger stuff. So then within just a couple days, they could do the whole park instead of having the smaller team do everything.
See, I don't know. Because when I was there for the transition between regular park to Halloween,
mm-hmm.
I was only in the park for 3 days,
mm-hmm.
and it went from nothing to everything, and they are efficient, those
but,
people
but
that
how
decorate.
Do you explain like Christmas though, because like snow was appearing on the castle like a week before Halloween?
Yeah, I think that they do that ahead of time just because it's such a big job.
Hmm.
I don't
it
know,
it just had me thinking, because I was just
yeah.
thinking like if they wanted to add like some realism to
yeah.
everything, you know.
I don't know, I think the longest piece of decorating is the castle, and I think that's because they have to be so careful
yeah.
doing that, plus there's cranes and it's this whole big production, versus like putting up the garland on Main Street. That stuff seems to go up pretty darn fast when
have
they
you,
do the actual like land decor stuff is what I'll call it.
Have you been to the parks for the holidays?
I have not been to Disneyland for Christmas
oh.
time. No,
I was just
or
curious
the holiday time.
From what you've seen,
I was
I
at
guess.
Walt Disney World for the holidays, but
I'll say from what you've seen then,
mm-hmm.
what's like your standout like decorated thing in the park that you like?
My standout decoration.
Well, what's your like favorite thing that they transition for the holidays? Like, do you like the garland? Do you like the tree?
Oh, the castle.
The castle.
The castle is my favorite. I wish they didn't do it before Halloween. That's my only gripe with that. But I do. I really like the castle. It's just it's such a simple effect, but it just transforms it, and it makes everything else feel more wintry when you're sure. in the middle of California.
I like the castle at night. During the day, the like icicles that they have, I don't really care for because yeah. I think they look kind of cheap and weird. And I was hoping this year that they would do something different because they kind of restyled yeah. some of the mm-hmm. the turret coverings and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I will say, in general, one of my favorite things is I love, and they got rid of it. In fact, I think we reported on this last year that they finally brought it back, was I really, in general, like Main Street.
Yeah.
The decorations. Mm-hmm. And I love the garland that goes across the street.
Oh, yes. Yep.
And so I was really happy last year that we were able to report that they brought that back, because with the taller parade floats of with the parades that they used to have, it was too tall. Mm-hmm. So it's nice now that they don't have that. So.
Well, speaking of the castle, Sleeping Beauty's castle transformation into the Winter Castle has been completed. The castle is now adorned with its snow-covered turrets, garland, and icicles. The roof covering that gives this look had to be completely repainted this year to complement the new color scheme for the castle. It looks great because the uh-huh. coverings, even though they are the same coverings that were on there last year, they did update the actual, I'm going to call them shingles, I don't know what sure. else you call them. They did update the shingles to match better the new colors that are underneath. I do like that the main one even has the pixie dust on it. They uh-huh. even, you know, they painted on the little stars for it. I don't know. I've kind of heard mixed reviews because they did change the look of the snow this year. Did you notice that? There's kind of more blues mm-hmm. in the snow this year.
I don't mind it.
It was getting some criticism online. I don't mind it either. I think it looks nice. It kind of ties in with the blues of the roof and just the whole thing in general. I don't know.
I think the new design is meant to be more whimsical and like feel more animated.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying of the castle in
yeah,
general.
Yeah.
And so I think if you were to draw a castle with snow, mm-hmm. it would have these blues. Like if you watched a movie with snow, yeah. it has these blues. So I think that's what they're going for.
See, now I hadn't even thought of that, but that makes total sense. And that's probably why it didn't feel super out of place to me. Now, of course, we have not seen this in person. We have just seen photos, but I like what I see.
I was going to say, if the photos are any indication, I think it probably looks great. Well, to help deck the halls at Disneyland, two VIPs installed the tree topper on the Disneyland tree in Town Square. Chairman of Disney Parks, Experiences, and Products, Bob Chapek. I hate that title. It is so long. And Disneyland Vice President, Chris Thieler, got strapped into a couple of cherry pickers and took a photo at the top installing the star. How awesome would that be?
I was just going to say, how much fun would that be? I mean, so cool to be the one putting the star on the tree in general, but I would love to be on a cherry picker and looking down Main Street at night. I don't know if they had everything lit up for Main Street, but I'm going to pretend it was. And that would just look amazing.
One thing I noticed in the picture that they posted of this, obviously it's a promotional picture kind of a thing. But one thing that I noticed that I thought was kind of cool was they took it from the person taking the picture was on the side of the castle, basically looking towards the train station. And you could, in the distance, you could see that Cars Land was lit up. And I wonder if that was... they were getting some decorations together for the Cars Land area, because that was like Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout is dark in this picture. Pixar Pier is dark in this picture.
You're right.
So it's just Cars Land is lit up. And then, of course, you know, like the it looks like Main Street is lit up because like the train station.
Yep, it does look, and the Opera House looks like it's lit up.
Yeah. The thing I thought was funny was the Disneyland Vice President, Chris Thieler, has like an Imagineering like hard hat on in this picture with her name, Chris. And poor Bob Chapek just has one that says Disneyland. So it's not even like his helmet. You'd think that the chairman of the parks would have his own, but maybe he left it at home that day or
maybe.
Something like that.
He has his name tag on.
That's true. It is a great looking picture. And like, it's amazing. Like it's cool to see the star that up close because we don't usually get to see it.
And how big it is. I mean, it looks giant compared to them, versus when you're standing on the ground looking up, it does not look.
It looks as tall as Bob Chapek is.
It does. It's very large. How high up do you think they are?
I'm sure that there's somewhere online that could tell us. In fact,
how tall the
producer
tree is.
James could probably Disney trivia question us with how tall is the Christmas tree in Town Square.
Let's not give him any ideas.
Well, I figure he's got to come up with some ideas to compete with producer Vern, who's like coming up with all types of trivia craziness.
Well, along with all of the decorations, nighttime entertainment will also be available for the holiday season. World of Color Season of Light will return since it was absent from the offerings last year due to damage with the jets. A Christmas fantasy parade will step off in Disneyland, and Believe in Holiday Magic will light up the sky above the park.
Now, I've never seen Season of Light. I'm excited to see that again return. Christmas Fantasy Parade, I'm ready for some updates. Although I did see online that one of the reasons that they probably haven't changed it is because it's been around so long that people have like that nostalgia with it. So if you did change something, people would probably be up in arms. Like if you got rid of the Tiki Room, for example.
It is funny because I have seen people, you know, they have made some changes to it, like some costume changes, that sort of thing. And so it was so funny because I saw someone comment online that they really wanted the basically the cross-eyed, goofy-looking reindeer to come back because they did have reindeer that had like it looked like their eyes were crossed and their tongue was kind of like sticking out. They were just funky, funny-looking reindeers, which I totally remember watching promotional things with those reindeer. Never seen them in person, but I knew exactly what they were talking about. My one Christmas wish, my holiday wish, is that poor Santa can make it down Main Street this year without getting pushed out of his sleigh like last year. Hopefully everything is 100% ready to go for Santa.
I feel like Santa's going to come down the street and they're going to have like steel girders like holding the thing up. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like all this extra stuff.
God.
Of course, Believe in Holiday Magic, which I love because the narrator in that I feel like is everybody's grandmother. And yes. I love the soundtrack. So I'm glad to see that come back. I did not see anywhere yet that said that they were going to go to projections only for that.
Oh,
so we'll wait and see because they've been doing that with everything.
Well, this is definitely a much busier time of the year for the park. So maybe it will be fireworks every night because attendance should be up.
Sure. Well, a new season brings some new food options. The first new churro is a peppermint chocolate churro. This one is drizzled in chocolate and peppermint and is covered in peppermint pieces. It looks like a crushed up candy cane on there. The holiday sprinkles churro is exactly what it sounds like, a churro covered in colorful sugar sprinkles. Finally, an icing and sprinkles churro that is covered in the other kind of sprinkles that are not just colored sugar crystals. So this last one are my favorite because I don't like the ones that look like crystals of sugar. Because I find it too crunchy, but I love the ones that you get like on donuts sometimes. It says they're kind of like tube shaped, you know, they're those little tube ones.
Yep. And there is one other churro. There's the sugar plum candy churro.
But that was returning from last year. So.
Oh, gotcha. You know, your icing and sprinkles churro even kind of looks like a glazed donut.
It does. And so, I love it.
I guess if I were going to be at the parks, the one I would probably try just out of curiosity would be the peppermint chocolate churro just because it's quite different. The other ones don't seem that adventurous and exciting to me.
The icing and sprinkles churro? Really?
I don't know. It's just, I don't know. I'm just curious about the peppermint chocolate on a churro.
I know this is really sad and because like apparently there's people that really love all these different flavors of churros. Am I the only one that really just likes the plain churro?
Oh, gosh. No, there is definitely. Churros are as iconic and as a staple of the Disneyland parks, Disneyland Resort, any Disney parks, as Dole Whip is.
Or the Mickey Premium Bars.
Yes. Well, I would argue that churros, I mean, I feel like we're going to hear some wrath on this, but I think, to me, a churro and definitely a Dole Whip are probably like when I think Disney snacks, those are the first two things that come to mind. And then the Mickey shaped pretzels and the Mickey shaped premium bar and the other Mickey shaped treats, they come too. But for some reason, those are what I think of.
What's interesting to me is that like churros are served other places, but people only really talk about churros at Disney.
You know, though, have you had a churro somewhere else? They're different at Disneyland.
No, because I just get
different
them at Disney.
In a good way. We were total side note. You don't have to put this in the podcast, but we tried, they have churros at Sam's Club, and we tried one, not as magical as a Disneyland churro.
I know.
Cheaper, but not as magical.
I know I saw online somewhere that there is a brand that like Disney uses, and you can buy them in some stores. I don't remember what it is off the top of my head. I'm sure we'll get an email or a comment about this.
Someone knows out there, I'm sure. Well, don't worry if you think you have missed out on all of the holiday offerings if you can't make it to the parks before the end of the year. From January 17th through February 9th, the Lunar New Year celebration will return at Disney California Adventure. This year, it is celebrating the Year of the Mouse.
How appropriate.
I know. That's what I thought, too. A couple weeks later, from February 28th through April 21st, the Disney California Adventure Food and Wine Festival will take place.
I really like the Lunar New Year celebration. I think it's really cool that they add a lot of like different cultural things. Obviously, we've seen like Dia de los Muertos has been a big deal at the parks. Lunar New Year is a big deal. So it's kind of cool that they have all these different things. I think this year there's going to be a lot of Mickey Mouse because it's the year of the mouse.
I'm curious. Do you think it's going to be a lot of Mickey or do you think they're going to keep it more traditional?
I don't know, but it's Disney. I
can see it both ways. I can see it both ways because this is definitely the time of year that we see characters that we don't normally see, like Mulan, Mushu, the Three Little Pigs. However, I don't know if they'll be out again because they were out because it was Year of the Pig.
That's what I'm telling you. So it's the year of... Because
we usually see Mickey and Minnie are usually there in their Lunar New Year finest. Goofy usually makes an appearance too. Yeah, that's a good point. Are we going to see more Mickey or is it going to be the same amount of Mickey as before?
That's a good question.
Time will tell.
I do, for years, I've liked reading about the Food and Wine Festival over in Epcot. So it's cool that California Adventure kind of has taken on this for the West Coast. And it's always different every time, right? Because they have different food items and different drink items and stuff. So it'll be more interesting once they start kind of, you know, posting what type of food options are going to be available. Plus back this year is the Sip and Savor Pass, which I think we talked about last year. That basically you should get the Sip and Savor Pass, but use it on the expensive things. Because if you use it on the cheaper things, it actually is not as good of a value.
If I lived there, I would definitely be hitting this up every weekend just to eat my way through the park. drink my way through the park.
How many food things have we talked about on this podcast?
Well, you know, there's so many different food options and offerings just in the park itself, but then they add in these extra events that bring in more delicious and amazing sounding foods. Maybe it's a good thing we don't live there.
we would gain a lot of weight and spend a lot of money.
Maybe it's a little bit better for our waistline.
Well, you know, if you can't wait until the new year or the Food and Wine Fest, the Festival of the Holidays is returning this year from November 8th through January 6th. There are 12 booths this year, including Brews and Bites, which offer local, seasonal, and international brews. Favorite things includes holiday ham shanks, an eggnog cocktail, and cranberry sangria from last year. Grandma's Recipes served candied yams, beef pot roast, and tart and fruity flight from last year. New this year is a shepherd's pie served with a Mickey-shaped topping. Other booths include holiday duets, making spirits bright, merry mashups, a twist on tradition, winter sliderland, and more. Okay. I love the names.
Yeah, so many different options. And, you know, they haven't released the full menus for these just yet. We do have, you can find, you know, a little taste, no pun intended, of the menus over at the Disney food blog. And gosh, from what I've seen, there's at least one, if not more, things from each of the menus that just sound awesome to me.
The shepherd's pie looks pretty good, actually. I love me some shepherd's pie.
That didn't look as appetizing to me, but that's why there's so many choices so that everybody can get what they want. I'm curious about this. There is a turkey and stuffing tamale with cranberry relish.
I don't know why I find it interesting that they're doing turkey and cranberry with a tamale.
I just want to try. I just need to know. This one also looks delightful.
Really good.
Is this really traditional Black Forest Yule log, which is over at A Twist on Tradition. It looks classic, but it just screams Christmas to me.
You know, you eat with your eyes first, and I'll tell you what, my mouth is watering looking at that one. Oh man, I just want to be there right now.
They're not, the booths aren't open yet though.
I know, but
you're just gonna get in line now.
I just want to drool on it.
Yeah, I guess you could taste test the booth.
I don't think that's as tasty.
I don't think so either. Well, a new line of retro merchandise has hit the shelves around the resort. Anyone who remembers the old VHS Disney animated classic will love the new journals that are about as thick as the old VHS cases and have that great look. Even so much so that if you open the first page, it looks like there is a cassette in your video cassette notebook. Yeah. A lot of merchandise with shows and characters from the 80s. Some of the shows are DuckTales and Chippendale Rescue Rangers, and it's merchandise like t-shirts, all sorts of fun stuff. Mm-hmm. Over in DCA at the Collector's Warehouse, there is a variety of retro games and other items from the 80s. I don't know why I was so excited about this, because it doesn't really fit to have non-Disney merchandise in a Disney park, but you can pull it off at the collector's warehouse. I just thought it was so great that they had very retro vintage kind of things there now. Everything that Star-Lord would have remembered from his time on our planet.
Yeah, I enjoy that. Although you got to remember, I mean, they kind of did something similar when the Toy Story movies came out, because that brought a lot of those things, like the Slinky things, you know, Mr. Potato Head. A lot of those retro things became popular again because they are kind of reutilized. So I grew up in the 80s. My brothers grew up in the 80s. So a lot of this stuff reminds me of like my early childhood. And so I do find it really interesting. I'm sure that some of these companies like the Simon, people that make Simon or Light Bright or the, what are those?
The viewfinders.
The viewfinders that you put the things in, it's 3D. Of course, there's some handheld electronic games. I remember these when I was a kid before, like video game systems were a big deal. So the fact that you can get all this stuff and it kind of adds to a whole different generation of people looking at this stuff, I think is pretty exciting.
I think it's very fun and cool that they're there. However, I do kind of question how many people would be purchasing those items. I think it's kind of a fun novelty to have in the store, but I'm not certain how sales would be for them.
And how much is the markup? Because it's a Disney park.
Yeah, you never know.
Well, the Redwood Creek Challenge Trail is closed to make way for the removal of the Villains Grove overlay that was installed for Oogie Boogie Bash. Of course, we kind of expected that this would be closed for a little while because there was so much there. I wonder if this puts to bed my idea that I was talking about last week, that they're going to use this for those villains nights in DCA. Remember I was saying that
that's
they might?
That's true. Yeah, that's very true. Well, but we also don't know for sure if they're going to have villains nights or not. It's just a rumor.
That's true. That's true. One last thing I wanted to say that we kind of threw in that I wanted to talk about, like we were talking right before the show about this. We didn't really have a news story about it. Two quick things. One is there's a Disney Plus booth coming to Downtown Disney.
Yeah.
Which,
okay. So we think it's kind of going to be like the Disney Vacation Club booths,
yeah,
where you can kind of sign up for the services or learn more about the services at these little information booths.
Sure. The other one that I thought was more interesting was that the construction walls have come down around the red car trolley stops in California Adventure. And one of the things that I thought was most interesting about this that got me thinking was people have talked about how it's going to stay closed for until Marvel Land is done next summer because of the fact that the tracks go through Marvel Land. Well, if they put these charging stations in the ground, which is what they kind of were working on, I'm wondering if they're going to just have it go from the one station on Buena Vista Street to the one right outside Mission Breakout and back again instead of having to go backstage. So I'm wondering if that'll kind of be just to kind of bring that attraction back and bring, you know, that movement around the area. So
this was for the stop that was on Buena Vista Street, which we were talking about this too. I'm trying to remember how long that had construction walls around it.
It feels like
it was a very, very long time. I don't know. I'm excited about this because, you know, there was a lot of speculation that perhaps the trolleys would be going away because of Marvel Land. So I'm very happy to see that they are not. I really didn't think they would because it's just, it's kind of like Main Street, right? We need that movement. But I do really like Tag said, the fact that they don't, that possibly this means that the trolley cars won't have to go backstage and that they'll just be out on the street more frequently.
Yeah, I hope so, because I like that kinetic energy of the stuff. And I really actually like the trolley. I usually ride it at least one time. One thing I'll tell you that I was really disappointed about was when we went to Disney World, that the horse-drawn carriage was only running in the morning and it was only with people with like cast members on it at Disney World. So I'm glad that ours continues to carry guests up and down the street. So
interesting.
Yeah.
I wonder why would they only have cast member? Like, why would a cast?
Because they have a show that like
takes place in
the hub in the morning. It's kind of like their like good morning
show.
So
it's kind of like on Buena Vista. What are they called?
Red Car Trolley.
Newsboys. Nope, not the Newsboys. They have that other show that has the band on that like rides up and down the streetcar.
Oh yeah.
On Hollywood Boulevard there. I feel bad that I don't remember what that performance group name is, but they've got the singer that has like the old fashioned microphone. Mm-hmm. But the only time you see that vehicle is when it's transporting those cast members. So maybe something like that. Well, now we take a trip to Trivia Land where producer James will try and stump us with some Disney trivia. He's going to read us the questions. We're going to try to answer them, and then he will give us the correct answers after our discussion topic. So what do you have for us this week, James?
I got some great ones for you this week, I think, and Worst case, you can mostly blame the listeners if it goes awry. So,
all those darn listeners always causing us problems.
Right.
So, I don't know. They got great questions.
They do, but that means that we're not getting them is the problem.
All right. Our first question comes from Elizabeth D. She says, when did the 5 millionth guest walk through the main gates of Disneyland?
Oh, boy.
Like, what, are you looking for like a month or a year?
I mean, I have a full date, but okay. I will accept a month with
a
the
month
year. So.
And a year. Oh, man. I'm going to say,
I want to say it was something like October of 1955. Because they like, they had a million, like they got to a million guests like super quick and then like they shot up from there. So I'm going to say something close like that.
I'm going to go a little bit further out. I'm going to say April of 1974.
You think it took that long to get 5 million guests?
I have no idea. I know it took longer than the first year. It had to have. I could be wrong.
I think you are.
You could be wrong. It's true. Question number two comes from Matthew H., and he says, as we all may know by now that the official address for Disneyland is 1313 Harbor Boulevard. However, did you know that when Walt was building the park and it was time to assign the address, the city of Anaheim allowed Walt to choose the address? So why did he pick 1313?
I think 13 was like his lucky number.
Yeah, I was going to say 13's his lucky number.
But there's also rumors that it was like 13 because the M is the 13th letter of the alphabet.
Oh,
so it's like
I
Mickey
have,
Mouse.
Yep, I have.
But that's
heard
always
that
been
before.
Rumors and never something like substantiated. But I think 13 was like his lucky number. Or he thought 13 was lucky. Like people usually think 13 is unlucky, but for him it was lucky.
I'm going to go with that. That's a hard one because you're right. I forgot that people talked about 13 being for an M.
We talked about this before, and I don't remember why, but we talked about like the address. Maybe it was another...
It was another trivia segment, because that's when I was answering trivia questions.
Oh, well then.
I feel torn on that, because I feel like the answer he could have provided would have gone either way. But I'm gonna stick with he wanted to go with 13 and use it for a lucky number.
Sure.
All right, our third question comes from listener Ryan H. Disneyland is starting to put Christmas decorations up. It's still too early. Where in Disneyland can you find a Christmas tree all year round, though?
Oh,
isn't it that one that's next to the castle? Because didn't they? Oh, in the Christmas shop.
Yeah, I was going to say in Fantasyland in that. I don't remember what the actual shop name is called, but it's in Fantasyland next to Peter Pan's flight. And you can always buy Christmas ornaments in there. I actually bought a Hatbox Ghost Christmas stocking when I was there last that I had never brought over
See,
for you to
I'm
look
torn
at.
Because I thought...
I'm going to say it's in there.
I thought that the Christmas shop was also in Frontierland or Fantasyland. But something else is tickling me and saying that for a while there was one in New Orleans Square because you can buy ornaments and stuff there. So is it in New Orleans Square or is it in Fantasyland?
I'm going to stick with Fantasyland.
I'm going to say New Orleans Square because I think Fantasyland, I think that one became the heraldry shop and that's like something totally different. So I'm going to say Christmas shop in New Orleans Square and I'm going to put you near Peter Pan.
Well, now we're done with the listener questions and now we come to me. We'll see how torn you are on this one.
Oh, no.
And I apologize for a name pronunciation. Glenda Guilfoyle was personally selected by Walt Disney to open Disneyland in 1955 for the park's Golden Horseshoe Review. She also holds a Guinness World Record. What is it?
Isn't it like most live performances or something like that? Is she part of that group that like did no?
I will give you a hint that you are on the right track. It is related to her performance abilities.
Oh, man. Related to her performance abilities.
Or at least her career choice, I guess, would be the better way to phrase that.
I can say with 100% honesty that I have no idea. Good question, James.
I don't know. I'm going to say like she was the first lead lady in a show like that? That's what I'll say.
Mm. See how you did. If you maybe set your own record for most questions right this week after our discussion topic.
Maybe our own record for most questions.
Wrong, I think.
Most questions wrong. So this week, our discussion topic, we're actually going to bring in a third person for the discussion topic because... we were originally going to do this discussion topic a couple of weeks ago when I was sick. And so somebody did a bunch of research on this. So producer James is going to join us for the discussion.
Yeah, can't get rid of me that easy this week.
So what is the discussion topic this week, James?
Well, we're talking about Disney legend Mary Blair.
Oh, yeah. So what do you know about Mary Blair, James?
Oh, Mary Blair had such an interesting relationship with Walt Disney throughout her career because he absolutely admired her work through so many different ways and places. And it really shows throughout her timeline of working with Disney and the impact that she's had through the years as it keeps on going to it.
So we have been giving Tag a little bit of a hard time on this because I suggested this topic a few weeks ago. Mm-hmm. He happened to be sick. James like went headfirst into all this research, and James and I have been like geeking out about Mary Blair since then. So I feel like Tag's kind of like the third wheel on this discussion, but
maybe
we'll like intrigue you. And so you'll kind of dig deeper into Mary Blair's very unique and very interesting history.
I was talking to James earlier about like what I thought that she did in the parks, and everything that I said to him, he was like, she did. And I was like, I do know a lot of stuff about Mary Blair without even having to do any research.
Well, we'll start at the beginning.
I love how you have this book, by the way. Can you describe this book to our listeners?
Oh, so so there are so many books online. If you look, because you know how you guys know how I am, how we talked about Kim Irvine, and I immediately thought we needed a Kim Irvine book because I wanted to learn more about her. So when we decided to talk about Mary Blair, the first thing I did was look online to see if I could find any books about Mary Blair. Turns out there's a lot of them. And interestingly enough, we'll kind of get probably into the details of why this is, but a lot of them are actually children's books. So the one that I purchased was actually called Pocket Full of Colors, The Magical World of Mary Blair, Disney Artist Extraordinaire. And it is so fun. I brought it over to show them because the coolest thing about it is it's her entire life story, but the illustrations are very much in her style. Mm-hmm. So I thought it was very, very cool. So
Can you describe how you described this book though to me? You're like, I'm gonna bring this book over because it's a children's book, so it was a very quick read.
Yeah, because I said I'm gonna bring the book over that I got of Mary Blair, and he's like, nothing. So I knew he'd be like, okay, why are you bringing this like huge book over? I don't have time to go through it. I said, it's a children's book, so it's a quick and easy read, but it's very cool. It's a very
unique
way of describing kind of her life, her relationship with colors, all that stuff. The story itself is very, very much geared towards children, but there is a very cool author's note that I'm going to be taking a lot of information out of to share with you guys for our discussion today. But anyways, back to the beginning. So Mary Blair was born on October 11th, in 1911, in McAllister, Oklahoma.
Oklahoma. Man, a lot of people that kind of did a lot of things for the Walt Disney Company, a lot of them were from the Midwest. So I'm kind of happy that, like, you know, with us being from the Midwest, or at least living in the Midwest, that we can kind of be, like, proud that some of these people went on some cool stuff.
That's true. Well, we're going to fast forward a little bit.
When she picked a school that she wanted to go to, she was actually awarded a scholarship and studied at the Cunard Art Institute in Los Angeles, and she graduated from there in 1933.
Yep, and after graduation, Mary actually did have a dream to have a career in fine arts, but she set that aside, and she actually took her first job at MGM in their animation unit.
It's worth noting that this was around the time of the Depression, so
yes,
anyone who was trying to get into art or artist or fine arts, the jobs just weren't there. So that's why a lot of artists of the time ended up in animation studios like MGM or eventually with Disney. Yeah, I think what's great about this is like, she had her story, and then she also married a fellow artist turned animator, and that was kind of the draw for her eventually to get into Disney animation. So they found their way there together, but she didn't stick around there long.
So she actually joined Walt Disney Studios in 1940, and her job was to create preliminary sketches to kind of guide the look and feel of the studio's animated film. Now the hard part here was she was one of the very few females in the studio, so that was obviously a challenge. But she also had a deep love of color, which back then, the nine old men were not as into color as Mary was. So she had a really rough go of it. She would hand her sketches off to the nine old men, and they were basically the nickname for that. That's the nickname, for those of you that don't know, for Disney's core group of supervising animators. And they kind of are responsible for the first works, you know, dating all the way back to Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. But they kind of pioneered many of the rules and guiding principle of animation that are still used today. So she had drafted sketches for Dumbo, Lady and the Tramp, and a sequel to Fantasia that was actually never produced. However, poor Mary, all of her sketches were pretty much rejected by the Nine Old Men because of her colorful and modern designs. So after just one very frustrating and stressful year on the job, Mary actually quit the Walt Disney Studios.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand like getting frustrated and having your work being shot down when like she believed in what she was doing and everything that was going with it. Like, I think as an artist, you have to have that bit of integrity to stand up. And if you believe you can do more than create other people's works, it's kind of what you got to do. And as we learned through her career, she's definitely like courageous and strong in so many ways. So I love the rumors that come after this, because after her stint outside of Disney, she ends up back on a plane with Walt Disney himself, as well as some other people, because Walt Disney was asked by the U.S. government to go on a handshaking mission to South America that moved on from being political to a learning experience for Disney and his animators to create animation, cartoons, and everything that would represent the cultures and help draw in that market. And so whether she was handpicked by Walt Disney to come along, or rumor has it she may have forced her way onto the plane and said, I'm coming on this trip with you, which would be kind of nuts. I mean, imagine us doing that to Walt Disney now. I'm like, yeah, you're going there, I'm coming with you.
Well, you know what though, like, it seems to me like Walt always knew how to pick like the right people, and so like the fact that she worked there to begin with, so he was like familiar with her, I'm sure. So I'm sure that like he could see something in her. So I can imagine that, like, okay, fine, like, but you quit, but you want to go, so like maybe it'd be a good inroad back for her, for him wanting her back, because like you said, she quit, so it's not like he got rid of her.
Yeah, she and you know, it wasn't, I don't know. I mean, obviously we weren't there, but it wasn't, she quit because of frustrations with, you know, trying to get her input and get her color and her ideas into the films, but the Nine Old Men just weren't having it. So from, you know, other people say that Walt was really connected with her because she kind of had a childlike, her drawings were very kind of childlike, very colorful. And, you know, Walt was, from everything that we've heard, basically a big kid at heart. So he definitely, you know, it sounded like he did connect with her. So another take on it is that he actually, they had become friends, and he was just actually really impressed with her color and her style that he invited her to join the tour. So who knows what actually happened there,
but had to be there.
But Mary did join the group. The group name was called El Grupo. Very original.
Creative, sure.
which was a select group of Disney illustrators. But yeah, I just think that's a very cool and a very unique experience, and something that, you know, in those times you didn't get to go travel to other countries to just study the countries and do stuff. So during her time there, she did a lot of paintings, a lot of watercolors, and, you know, kind of just took in all of this information, and sounds like she really flourished and really loved her time there.
I feel like looking at her work, this is such a turning point for her artistic style, because this is where the colors really start to pop, and you get that idea, like you said, the painting and the watercolor is a different take on that. Like, it's her true passion in art, and I mean, I think she started playing with charcoal while she was down there too, as another art form to really go with, and just kind of the stylized figures that came out of that, like the characters that she was able to create after that experience. Like, I wish that it could be more easily seen. Unfortunately, it's a podcast talking about a very visual artist.
Right.
Of just like the transformation, and I imagine the confidence that comes following this trip.
Well, after this trip, Mary did rejoin the Disney Studios as an art director, and she worked on films such as The Three Caballeros, which was actually a film inspired by this the trip that they had just come back from, which, if you have seen that movie, very fun, very colorful, very different. It's one of those things that I guess I never noticed it, but when you think of films like Snow White and the Seven Dwarves and just how that looked visually versus a film like The Three Caballeros, it just color-wise, how different those two films are. I feel like Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs is plays around pretty much with like your traditional primary colors. So red, green, blue.
Well, also, I'm just thinking back to Snow White, and it seems very like muted.
Yeah. Which, I mean, it was the, you know, it was one of the first animated right. films from the studio. So obviously it's not going to have the greatest and best technology.
Sure.
But just the color between the two is crazy. And we'll kind of get into some of the other films that she had a hand in too. And just think, when we talk about those films, just think about how that film looks visually versus like I said, like the original, like Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. It's something I never really was aware of and didn't notice until, you know, studying about and reading about Mary Blair. And then suddenly you're like, oh my gosh, there is a difference. And mm-hmm. the difference was her.
Like, I think this was great because as she came back, she finally got to be like the lead producer. So she wasn't asking other people for permission for, can this be my look? Mm-hmm. But I did remember reading or hearing that animators still had problems working with her because of her art style. It wasn't naturally three-dimensional, so it was difficult to animate. Oh. And so they had to work a little harder to make her pictures come to life.
Interesting. That's cool.
So, yeah. And also, her style is less realistic. Mm-hmm. You noted, it's very childlike. And so it also another struggle. So
some other films that Mary did kind of have a hand in, I guess. And her designs were incorporated in classics like Cinderella, Alice in Wonderland, and Peter Pan, to name a few of the most popular ones.
Well, she also worked on partially animated ones like Song of the South and So Dear to My Heart. So, because there is an animated aspect of that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. The Adventures of Ichabod and Mr. Toad.
Oh.
That's the other thing, too. Yeah. So that's what I'm saying. Like, think of the colors and what you see in Alice in Wonderland and Peter Pan versus Snow White.
Alice is very colorful.
Very
right.
colorful. You don't even, and that's the thing, you kind of don't notice how colorful it is until you take a step back and compare it from things that were earlier. And yeah, sure. We have Mary to thank for that.
And I know this is jumping way ahead, but I still think about her influence like today and in recent films. Like when we host the episode and Casper asked us trivia about her, like my first thought was Monsters, Inc., because that's such a colorful mm-hmm. experience. It's very much a Mary Blair style film. I'm like, Her influence is still here today on those films.
Definitely. Well, Mary actually decided to leave the Walt Disney Studios again in 1953. She did have a little trouble finding work after that. She moved to New York and she became an in-demand commercial artist. And she did kind of all sorts of freelance stuff at that time. Things like she was a Broadway set designer and she was also a picture book illustrator for one of the very popular series that I'm sure all of us had when we were growing up was the Little Golden Book.
Oh, books. I remember those. Mm-hmm. Those ones with like the little golden spine, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. She did have her own little golden book. It was I Can Fly by Ruth Crass and it's actually still in print today.
Oh, wow. One of the things that I think is like, for me anyway, is something that is like iconic Mary Blair is this next thing, which is when Disney had to start working on the It's a Small World attraction for the New York World's Fair in 1964-65, Walt actually requested her to work on this attraction. And actually, I remember in the thing I talk about all the time, which was that 10th anniversary special where Walt is walking people through and showing stuff, they actually have her there showing the facade of It's a Small World. And one of the things that I found most interesting, because you guys have talked so much about how she deals with color, is that the way she was looking at the facade is she was using lights to kind of see what the facade would look like in different colors. Instead painting the thing, she was kind of, in fact, in this video, you can see that she kind of is like moving lights around it. And of course, originally the facade at the park was white and gold mm-hmm. like it is mm-hmm. now. For a while, it did turn into kind of a pastel color later on. But for the original thing, she worked on it. So when I think of Mary Blair, the first thing I think of is It's a Small World.
You know, and I think that's probably what most of us think of when we hear her name, too. Because honestly, I didn't know that she had such a big hand in so many of everyone's favorite animated Disney movies. So that was really exciting for me to find that out. But she was very excited when Walt Disney contacted her because he basically did call her to design this attraction. And so she was free to do and create whatever it was that she saw fit for this attraction. And, you know, it really shines through because she definitely did a lot of research because obviously she did not go all around the world to go research each of these countries and each of these different cultures. But it's such a fun colorful, very playful, obviously very kind of a child. It almost feels like you're stepping into like a child's storybook when you're on that attraction.
Yeah, I think what we can't undersell with this too is like this attraction wasn't originally on the list for the World's Fair. The organizers came and asked Disney to do a fourth pavilion, and this is what he came up with. So again, it's that relationship with Mary Blair that you talked about, Teresa, where he came and handpicked her once again.
They were actually only given 11 months to create and build the pavilion that then It's a Small World was going to be a part of. So the fact that that attraction came together that quick, just the fact that that facade came together that quickly is just mind-boggling.
Well, think about this. So how long does it take for a new attraction today? I mean, I know it's a lot more advanced, but can you imagine if Disney could now, from concept to open, 11 months, that'd be crazy. Wouldn't it? Yeah. I mean, I think it'd be, I mean, obviously things were a little more simple back then, but just think of the manpower, because all of those dolls had to be sculpted and created. So in 11 months, you must have had like an army
of
people.
And clothed, and I mean, it's not a short attraction either. Plus, they didn't, and they had to, you know, get the ride vehicles and get all that right, plus the fact that they decided it was going to be water. That seems like it'd be more complicated. So it's, it's really incredible.
Yeah, if they had that timeline, City of Anaheim would probably just be Walt Disneyland.
Right.
The whole city would just be Disneyland.
So there is a couple things that I also think about with Mary Blair. In fact, it was funny because when I was talking to producer James before the episode today, I said, here's what I know about Mary Blair. And I talked about it. It's a Small World. And I talked about these next couple things. And that's kind of was like my limit of knowledge with Mary Blair.
Yeah. So before we move on, I did want to add that another famous name that a lot of people will probably recognize, Raleigh Crump, was actually an assistant on the It's a Small World project. He, I know him best because of things like Pirates and Haunted Mansion.
Right.
But he said of Mary Blair, he was quoted saying, "I don't think she mixed paint very much. She used all and every color. That's the thing I learned from her. Don't be afraid of color, Raleigh."
I mean, it shows in everything she's done, right? Because it's like definitely color. And who, you know, people, I think people notice color, but a lot of times they don't think about
color. Well, and I thought that was really interesting, too, that she wouldn't mix the paint. She just used the color in its pure,
natural form. So two things that I also knew about Mary Blair. One of them, you can't really see anymore. But she actually did a mural in Tomorrowland on each of the fronts of the buildings for what is now what is now Star Tours and Buzz Lightyear. And actually, right now, with the current mural that's there, the original tile mural that Mary Blair did is actually under that still. So maybe someday, maybe with a Tomorrowland redo, if they don't get rid of those buildings, or if they do get rid of the buildings, maybe they can salvage that, somehow.
That'd be great.
That would be really awesome. For those of you who had never seen this in Tomorrowland, it was kind of like the tile mural that you would see in the entrance of California Adventure when it first opened, because that was also a large tile mural. So then once again, there was another large tile mural that she was able to create at the Contemporary Resort that actually goes up kind of the middle elevator section of the Contemporary. And I remember you can see it if you go in on the monorail. Yep. And one of the things that it is known for is that there is a I think it's a goat that has five legs.
Five-legged goat. Oh. Yes, that is the famous part of that for sure.
It looks like the five, if you are looking for the five-legged goat, we did find him on the mural. He is towards the top.
And that mural was Mary Blair's last work with the Disney company. So that's her final mark on everything Disney.
No. You know, and it has a very Small World feel to this mural doesn't it?
Well, the faces of the characters are very round, dolls.
Yeah, they look like the dolls. The other thing too, did you say that this is a 90-foot tall mural?
I did not give any specifics. I just said what I knew
about
it. I
may or may not have given any specifics.
So that's what I think about when I think of her. It's a Small World, and I think of these murals that used to be in Tomorrowland, which at the time I thought was weird because they didn't really fit with Tomorrowland.
Right.
But they're still there, and I'm glad that Disney didn't just destroy them.
Yes. That definitely would have been a piece of Disney history that would have been very forgotten. Well, Mary Blair did pass away in 1978, and everyone kind of felt like maybe her art would end up kind of as a footnote in the history of Walt Disney Studios, and maybe the only thing that she'd be remembered for is It's a Small World. However, this kind of began to change as different animators rediscovered Disney's golden age, and with it, of course, they discovered Mary Blair. So in 2008, Mary Blair was named a Disney legend, and 2 years later, she got her own Google Doodle on what would have been her 100th birthday.
You know you've made it when Google makes a Doodle for you.
It's very, very cool. And then also just to add, in 2014, the Walt Disney Family Museum did host a retrospective of her work. I actually found, we can post a link to it because the Walt Disney Family Museum website does have information about that room and about Mary.
I love what you mentioned about how the animators would go back and look at it. Like, mm-hmm. I think that speaks volumes to what her legacy can and will continue to be. Like, when we think about famous artists of the past, like, you know, it's can you compare Mary Blair to like a Vincent Van Gogh? Like it's a very different time that you're looking at in terms of Van Gogh creating masterpieces of art for art, and Mary Blair mixing with animation and murals and everything else. And so I don't know if there's a definite answer to that by any means, but I think it's worth the discussion for everyone as they learn about her.
Yes, definitely.
I'll tell you what, I'm looking at the Walt Disney Family Museum site, and they have a link to some of the images that were on display in this exhibit.
Some of the artwork. Mm-hmm.
And this one of Tiger Lily and Peter Pan dancing on the campfire concept art from 1951 is amazing. I just love the colors because there's dark colors. And bright. And
Well, and even this next one here, which is the pirate ship when it's flying through the air, just the fact of that she decided to paint the or to color the pirate ship as like a teal green more so than the traditional colors of what a pirate ship would be. I mean, just think of Alice in Wonderland. If Mary Blair didn't have influence with that, what I mean, the colors that we love that we don't even notice that we love about Alice in Wonderland, like think of things like the flamingos that they use when they're doing the croquet, the very fun, colorful colors that they have, the flamingos. They're not just your traditional looking flamingo. They're very unique and very playful. I mean, even like the Cheshire Cat, he probably wouldn't have been purple and pink without Mary Blair's influence.
I think I'd go a step further. I don't think Walt greenlights Alice in Wonderland without Mary Blair's influence.
That's true.
Because I think you're right that the colors are really what make that.
Wonderland could be very much Mary's world.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's kind of the vision. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's so much to talk about her childlike view of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how she's able to create things that are able to last for decades, where we still look back at Alice in Wonderland as a treasure when people are still lining up to ride It's a Small World.
Yes. Well, and even the Alice in Wonderland attraction, the Peter Pan attraction, is crazy popular.
Always.
I'll post a link in the show notes. I found a Yesterland article that shows these murals from Tomorrowland and some of the details. And then they show that it's been covered over. So if you guys are interested in seeing what that looks like, because it is amazing. And it also has a picture of the Google Doodle.
It does have her Google Doodle.
Oh, perfect.
Well, again, the book that I had purchased, if you guys are curious, is called Pocketful of Colors. I'll pass this over so you guys can read it quick. But I just thought it was a very cool... very cool explanation of her life and just kind of her love of colors and how it kind of grew with her as she, you know, grew into being an adult, and how color kind of shaped her life.
Again, it's made me think a lot about color. And I think probably next time I see these movies that she's been a part of, I'll definitely pay a little bit more attention to some of the colors in the movie. And I think hopefully some of our listeners, when they see these movies next time, will also think about that. And when they go to It's a Small World, or they go, you know, if they're in Disney World, they go to the Contemporary, they can look at some of her work. If you see that video, too, from the 10th anniversary of Disneyland, she's actually in that, so you could see her talk about her colors a little bit. So,
and as always, if anybody has any other very interesting facts that they know about Mary Blair or trivia or tidbits, anything like that, please pass them our way. Again, you can shoot them through either Facebook, Instagram, or you can send us an email at feedback@dlweekly.net.
Well, if you enjoyed the show, please leave a review on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to the show. By leaving a review, it helps get our ranking better and allows the community to grow.
Well, we hoped you enjoyed listening to this episode of DL Weekly. You can support the show for as little as 25 cents an episode. If you'd like access to our supporter chat, it's just 75 cents an episode. So please consider joining supporters like Eric J and head over to dlweekly.net/support.
Well, now it's time to return to James over in Trivia Land, which I guess James never really left, to get the answer.
No, we went to Mary Blair Land.
Mary Blair Land, yeah.
It was a sprint to get back here in time.
All right, tell us how bad we've done.
So our first question came from Elizabeth D., and she asked, when did the 5 millionth guest walk through the main gates of Disneyland? Tag, I'm going to give you a point, because it was October of 1956.
Ooh.
So a year
off. I had
the
month right. Crazy.
That's pretty crazy.
Not April of 74.
No, definitely did not take that long. So the last count I was able to find online dated back to 2017, when they had 708 million visitors.
Wow.
So yeah, that park definitely brings guests in.
I can't wait till a few years from now when it'll be the 1 billionth guest.
That's just mind-boggling to me, because I guess I'm aware that I'm not the only person when I visit a Disney park.
Are you
but,
sure?
You know, they just have it set up so well that you really just don't realize how many people are there, and I have no idea what the capacity for the, you know, how what is when they reach capacity, how many people is that? It's really mind-boggling when you
Galaxy's
start thinking
Edge
about it.
Oh, but definitely. I believe that I read online before it was some, because they never release actual numbers. Mm-hmm. I remember reading somewhere it was between like 65,000 and 75,000 people
is
their capacity.
It's crazy because that is bigger than the town. That is much bigger than the town I live in.
But let's think. But let's think about this. Let's just say on an average day, let's say 40,000 people go. That adds up very quick.
That's crazy.
40,000 a day. So
I'm still surprised that they got to 1 million in over a year. You know,
just
a year
over
and a half.
Year. Yeah.
So, hold on, I'm just going to do some quick math. 40,000 times 365, let's just say, that's 14.6 million a year. And we know from the thing that it's at like 18 million a year. So, think about that. So, actually, if we clear this and we do 18 million.
I hope you're keeping all
podcast math.
365.
The best stuff.
So, almost 50,000 a day average.
That's bigger than your town and my town combined.
Yeah, you could like double both
of ours. That's just crazy.
But
it's amazing.
It's still smaller than La Crosse.
I know, but still, it's just amazing.
All right, our second question came from Matthew H. As we know by now, the official address for Disneyland is 1313 Harbor Boulevard. Oh, yeah. When Walt picked the address, why did he pick the 13th? And you actually got both rumors right that I was able to uncover. So Matthew's submission was Mickey Mouse referring to 13 as the 13th letter of the alphabet. But I had also seen the rumors that 13 was a lucky number. So points all around.
Woo!
Our third question came from Ryan H. Disneyland is starting to put Christmas decorations up. Where in Disneyland can you find a Christmas tree all year round? We might have to get some checks on your answers, but that's not the one Ryan gave me. Ryan said you need to go to Goofy's Playhouse, and he always has a tree up in the attic.
Interesting.
We might need some confirmation from our listeners on this one.
Sure.
So, but I mean,
it's not the time of year.
It is the holiday season. It's not fair. All right. Someone remember in 6 months to go and check it out.
Yeah, I'm almost positive that little tree's in the corner.
All right. And our last question. Glenda Guilfoyle was personally selected by Walt Disney to open Disneyland in 1955 for the park's Golden Horseshoe Review. She now also holds a Guinness World Record. Which one?
Oh, I'm curious about this one.
And the answer is she is the oldest chorus line member.
Oh.
Yeah, so she earned the award just before she retired in 2010. And she was, let me make sure I get this right. She was less than a month away from being 77 years old.
Wow.
When she was performing. She wasn't performing at Disneyland. Obviously, at that point, she was performing down in Palm Springs.
Wow.
So why didn't she just wait that extra month or whatever and get 77?
You know, sometimes it's just the right time to retire. But holy cow. Like, started dancing for at least Walt in 1955 and didn't retire until 2010. That is a lifetime of dance.
2 points for me, 1 point for you. Woo!
Well, I had a good time asking a lot of listener questions mixed in with my one. Let's get some more next week so we can keep on stumping TNT together. Send me an email. It's trivia@dlweekly.net.
Thank you, Elizabeth D., Matthew H., and Ryan H. for submitting the questions. Also to producer James for stumping us with that last question.
Oh, you're welcome.
Good ones. Well, we will be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.